Hi friends, welcome again to our amazing program, The Purpose Driven Life. We decided to come live with this program so as to take as many people as possible on board with us on this journey. We are live on Instagram, we are live on Facebook, and we are recording this for YouTube. So yesterday when we carried on, what happened, we kept having technical difficulties, which has also held us back a bit more today, because we normally want to start at 9 o'clock. So if you find that we've clicked off for no reason that you're aware of and you're missing out on what we're discussing, then later go on YouTube and just pick it up, because it's on YouTube. We're putting everything on YouTube. Okay, what's exciting about this? I'll tell you a little story that happened to me yesterday. Late in the night, I had to speak with my daughter who's in university at the moment. And she is in one of those, you know when you have one of those moments where everything sounds like you're not getting anywhere. And we had to spend a long time talking about what things, you know, what's going on and how she's feeling, and eventually I was able to pull her out of the mood. So that's what happens to most of us, you know, most of the time. We have scenarios where you suddenly get to that point in life and you wonder, am I actually getting anywhere? What am I really doing? Okay, occasionally if you hear noises in the background, we have students in training, and so we cannot stop their training because we want to be chatting with you. So ignore the noises that you may hear in the background. Okay, so there are times when you have these moods where you start questioning yourself. What is going on in my life? Am I going in the right direction? Why does everything feel so down? That's why we decided to do this. Because I got to that mood as well when I started feeling, where am I really going and what's going on? I don't feel I'm making any more sense to myself. And so that was when I remembered this book, Purpose Driven Life. So if you're joining us for the first time, this is a book we're reviewing, and it's a 40-day journey, and today is day 3. But before I go into that, let me just read something I read from this book yesterday, Walking with the Law. It says, as you grow in knowledge and are able to form better opinions, do not hesitate to change your views. Remember, the wise man changes his mind and the fool never. There can be no progress without change, no growth without renewal. There must be a constant stream of new thought, better thought and truer thought to ensure progression in life. As soon as you perceive the better, let go of the old. Grasp the new. To continue to hold on to the old and inferior when the new and superior is at hand is to retard growth. And to this one cause may be traced many of the ills of man. To this one cause may be traced many of the ills of man. So this is what this book is trying to do to us, and this is what I tend to come across when I feel down and things are not working. I dive into books, and this is where personal development helped to strengthen us, because we decided to make this a journey for as many people as possible to come with us to understand what goes on behind the scene most of the time. I was watching Gary Vee, and he said something that really touched me. He said, document the journey. And we are in a time now in our lives where everything can be documented. We talked about Facebook, we talked about Instagram, we talked about YouTube, and then there's so many more, you name them, Snapchat, LinkedIn, there's so many out there. And he went to explain that lots of people think, because they call it social media, it's not for them. They don't want to grow with it. But we forget that the same way we touched lives in the past before these things came on, that's the same way these things are touching our lives. So once you see something new that's better than what was old, you have to join it. You have to be part of it. And we are trying to document this so that people understand the fact that nothing in life just happens. I mean, I was thinking to myself this morning, that song, Beyonce, I woke up like this, flawless. Nobody woke up like this, flawless. Everybody puts in some work. And the other day, I was having a chat with my sister, and we're just talking about how things are going way back in Nigeria, especially in rural state where I come from, where the youths have completely lost it. They just, the culture we have in Nigeria is just get into politics and, you know, just steal as much money as you can from the system and share all this wealth, and then everybody hails you. And in the process of doing that, because there's only a few people that can get to these positions, they've now encouraged the young ones to think that that's what life is. Life is just wake up and become overnight success. And I explained to my sister, you know, it is our fault. We are the ones who are raising the younger ones. We are the ones who should guide them and show them the right path to follow. We are the ones who have created this generation of 30-year-olds, 35-year-olds still living at home with parents. In our days, it wasn't like that. I mean, I remember when I was younger, we looked up to other older people and they guided us in the right path. They told us you work hard. They told us go to school. They told us get education, get information, get knowledge. But what we're doing nowadays, we're just pampering our children and making them feel that, you know what, you can never get hurt. There's a program I watched on YouTube and it called it the Millennial Children. I circulated it to as many of my friends as possible who have kids like me. Because we have grown our children to believe that life is so easy. And then when they get to workplace and then they're being told to do things, suddenly they're in shock. Because now they realize that it's not as easy as it was at home. And without the upbringing I had, I decided to also raise my children like that. So they've known what it's like to struggle. And that's why I've just explained that. I was chatting with my daughter for hours last night. Because when things get tough, you have to get tough. There's a saying, when the going gets tough, only the tough get going. So people who are out there thinking life is so easy, it will get to a point where it gets tough and then you struggle. So once you get new knowledge, which is what we're doing with this program, it's about changing your mindset and understanding that things are different. You realize that you have to take the new thoughts. And that's what this Walking with the Lord just explained to me. Raymond Holywell, if you want to try and get a bit more understanding from that, that's a book that I will also read again and again. It talks about the 11 forgotten laws. But I'll come to that when I'm done with this one. So yesterday we talked about the bank account. And I did say, you announce your bank balance. And somebody was asking me, can you explain a bit more? Whatever created the bank balance you have today, you are part of it. It could be from your lack of doing or from what you have done that wasn't the right thing to do. And that's where I am as well. I've been doing so many things and somehow I still feel maybe I'm not on the right track. And so that's why we're looking at this book. So we need to redirect ourselves to the right place. And once the man says purpose-driven life, I became curious. I haven't read this book to the end. That's why I'm reading it with you. And so you can also change the actions that you took. You can go a different route. Once you know what you're doing, life starts to change. Once you have a superior thought, things start to change. That's where we're going. And another thing I want us to understand too is most of us follow only beaten paths in life. You only do something because everybody else is doing it. This is where we go wrong completely. I had a call the other day and someone saying to me, I want to learn how to create frontal weaves because all the girls in my neighborhood, that's the only thing they want to wear. And what I say to students who come to me here is, if you want to go into wig making, you need to start with a weave. Because wig making is just a fad, it's just happened. It's only recently we noticed Beyonce, Rihanna, all of them wearing wigs, and suddenly we all want to wear wigs. Okay, I love wearing wigs, so it's not a problem. But when you want to create something that only just happened, and there's a bigger thing behind that, why would you not choose to pick up the bigger thing and then add on the extra thing that's just the latest thing? Because I remember when we had lace front wig, where we had to take glue and glue it down. And now we don't do that anymore. I remember going on a course for that. And today there is no need for that anymore. So it's like when you just follow what everybody is doing, you become like everybody. And then you don't stand out. And this is when you hear people saying, be a square peg in a round hole. You have to be different for you to stand out. And I say to people, if you want to be seen, give people something to see. You don't blend in and expect people to see you. You don't want to be like everybody else and then you'll be picked out of the crowd. So these are little things that will start guiding us to start thinking differently, because this whole thing is about how we think. And how we think, I could probably have come here and say, let's read this book, Think and Grow Rich. Think and Grow Rich is one of those classical books that everybody who's made it out there, one way or the other, read this book. But you know what made me choose purpose-driven life? Because it's taking us into our spirit. Think and Grow Rich, you're thinking. But where will the thoughts come from? The thoughts start from your spirit. And so if you haven't put the right thoughts in, what thoughts are you going to think that will help you grow rich? Do you see the way I'm reasoning? And so we need to help the thoughts that are coming into our heads to be the right thoughts before we can use those thoughts to create what we're looking for. So I'm documenting this journey for people to see how I strengthen myself as well. So people don't sit out there and say, oh yeah, she's so lucky. Because that's what you hear all the time. Once you see somebody that's achieved something, oh, she's so lucky or he's so lucky. Nobody knows the hard work that goes on underneath that luck that you see. I mean, what Gary Vee was saying, which was really very touching, is if today all of us looked at the man who was behind the iPhone or Apple, Steve Jobs, and he documented his journey, how he got there, we would all have been watching it. So if you don't document your journey, how will people know what you went through? We're not saying that everybody will have time like I'm doing now to do this, but at least there'll be something to remind you the journey you went on. And it's again to empower the young ones that are thinking it happens overnight, that it's not something that just happens overnight. It's something that takes a lot of work. So all of us adults out there with younger generation, we need to start giving them the right path to follow. We need to start supporting them. Because if we don't, I don't know what future they are going to come up with. We need to help our young ones right now so they can create a better future tomorrow and also be able to help their children. Okay, so enough of all that long talk. Let's delve straight into chapter 3. Today is day 3. And chapter 3, you remember our little card that we are using to scribble the things we really want to talk about. Chapter 3 says, what is driving your life? That's the big message. And I think this is one of the biggest ones because it goes with the title of the book, Purpose Driven Life. It says, nothing matters more than knowing God's purpose for your life, which is what we just talked about earlier. Like, you wake up some days and you get into these moods and you're asking yourself questions, am I really on the right track? So we do that. He said, nothing can compensate for not knowing them. It's not success, it's not wealth, it's not fame, it's not pleasure. These are not the things that should really be driving your life. You say, without a purpose, life is motion without meaning. Without a purpose, whatever you're doing is like you're just in motion, but it has no meaning. It's just activity without direction. So you are absolutely active, but which direction are you going to? It's just events without reason. And I think that really touched me. So it says, without a purpose, life is trivial. Life is petty. And life is pointless. So it's something we need to put into our consideration. And he gave an example. He says, he knew a young man in his 20s that wrote, I feel like a failure because I'm struggling to become something and I don't even know what it is. All I know how to do is get by. This was a young 20-year-old asking himself, I know I'm struggling, but I don't know what I'm really struggling for. And he says, someday if I discover my purpose again, I'll feel I'm beginning to live. So I'm sure, and I know lots of us feel that way. We just find ourselves like you wake up every morning and say, oh, thank God for another day. Oh, I'm still here. Okay. So what should I do today? Because we don't really know why we're here. And that's what we're trying to find out. You say, without God, life has no purpose. And without purpose, life has no meaning. And without meaning, life has no significance or hope. He said the greatest tragedy is not death. Because lots of us, we mentioned this yesterday, we're so scared of dying. Oh my goodness, everybody hates me, they want to kill me. Oh, they're trying to poison me. They're trying to do this to me, especially if you're African or Nigerian like me. Everything that goes wrong, you have a headache, someone has caused that headache. He said the greatest tragedy is not death, but life without a purpose. And that's the way I see it. So if you are just living for no reason, you can tell yourself why you're doing what you do, then that's tragedy. He said there's nothing quite as potent as a focused life. So once we can focus our life, that's when you are on purpose. So those are the little scribbles that I put in the notes. And we'll be more than happy to answer your questions. If you have any, please feel free to write us and ask us anything that's bothering you. So some of the things I wrote down from the book, Ready to Chat with You, is we did say the title of this chapter is What Drives Your Life. And somebody wrote, this is in the Bible, Ecclesiastes 4. Verse 4, it says, I observe that the basic motive for success is the driving force of envy and jealousy. That's Ecclesiastes 4, verse 4. And that's Solomon writing. He said, everyone's life is driven by something. So start looking at yourself now. There's something that makes you do something. Something drives you. Something motivates you, something encourages you to do something. But what is this driving force? What is really driving you? And that's what we're trying to find out now. You may be driven by many or either of the following. So he gave some examples of the things that he thinks starts to drive people's lives. He says some of us are driven by guilt. So we spend life running from regrets and hiding our shame. So something that we may have done and we're not proud of, that becomes the thing that's really driving us. And so we're constantly waking up and wondering, let me avoid this, let me not do this anymore. And then because I did this last time and this happened, let me run away from it. So what we then do, we allow our past to control our future. So because we did something last, at some point in our time, in our life, and it wasn't what we wanted, and we get moved by that action that we did, so we now use that to drive our future. So some of us get driven by regrets and by guilt. And he gave an example. You remember Cain in the Bible when he killed his brother? And God did say to him, he's not going to have, you know, he's going to just wander about in life without any proper purpose. And so he explained that, yes, just like Cain, most of us are like that. Most people wander through life without a purpose. But he's advising you don't have to be a prisoner of your past, because that's what it is. And that God's purpose is not limited to the past. He gave an example. You remember Moses? Moses actually did murder an Egyptian. I remember in the Bible when there were two people were fighting, and then Moses got involved and he killed one of them. He said Moses was a murderer. But in the end, what happened? God actually chose Moses to lead the Israelites. So his future. Yes, he did something that wasn't right, but he got forgiven because he asked for forgiveness. And now he was now the person that was chosen to lead the Israelites, the chosen ones. So his past did not determine his future. And that's what we have been told now. Slowly we need to start letting go of all these things that are holding us back. It is not your past, it is your present. And that's one of the things that Eckhart Tolle talks about in his New Earth, Create a Better Life. So he explains that most of us hang on to the past so much. We keep pulling the past into the present. Everything that goes wrong, he calls it the pain body. We switch and then the pain body comes back. And once that happens, because our physical body cannot respond to anything else but what's in our mind, we automatically become that past. And then now the past in us in the present then dictates our future. And so this is where you then hear you attract a law of attraction. Because now you're in the past, everything you're attracting now is negative. Some of us get driven by resentment and anger. And this group hold on to hurt and never let go. Again, the pain body. So anger is what's really making you wake up in the morning, because I'm so angry. You know what? Let me go do this thing. I'm angry. Those who have hurt you in the past cannot continue to hurt you unless you hold on to the pain. So if someone had hurt you in the past, that past is gone. It's past. Unless you give them the reason to hurt you again, it is gone. And so let go of the past. Don't let the past be what's driving you. Don't let anger be what's driving you. It is you who's hurting yourself. This person who supposedly hurt you has forgotten what happened. And I say to people, even when they remember, you remember when Jesus on the cross said, Lord, forgive them because they know not what they do. They don't even know what they're doing to you. Sometimes they may feel they've done something and it's meant to hurt you. But once you don't take it to heart, it doesn't hurt you. And what happens, what I read in some places too, is you get hurt twice. Because they've hurt you right now, but you are carrying it on. So that carrying it on is the second hurt. So you get hurt continuously. But you could let go and carry on your life. And for me, I just feel sometimes this thing about anger and hurt comes from expectations. Because most of us sit back and we have in our head what we expect from another person. But the one person you can change is yourself. You cannot change another person. No matter what relationship you have with this person, your husband, your children, your mother, your sister, your friends, you cannot change another human being. And so you need to realize that the expectations you have, which has been met short because this expectation wasn't what came out, that's when the anger comes in. That's when the hurt comes in. So there's I read somewhere that those who don't expect anything never get hurt. So that's what you need to remember. Less expectations, your life will be a lot better. And so the next one, so we talked about driven by guilt, driven by resentment, and the next one is driven by fear. And so fear is caused by many things. Traumatic experiences, unrealistic expectations, we just talked about, growing up in a high controlled home, which I know lots of people who all they want to do to their children is hold them down like they are possessions. Or some of us, we do that to our husbands, so we hold them down, we don't even want them to step out of our sight. Or some husbands do it to their wives, oh no, where are you going now? And so when you have all of this fear locked up in you that's driving you, all it will bring to you is problems. Fear-driven people miss great opportunities in life. They are afraid based on these fears, so they stop themselves. They play safe. They avoid risk. They maintain status quo. And I know a good example is about us Black people, especially living in the West. Most times we stop ourselves because we think in our head, oh yeah, because I'm Black, they're not going to let me do this. You automatically stopped yourself even before you try. And you know, there are times when even with food, there are people who say, oh, I don't want to taste it. And I said, but have you tasted it before? No. So why do you not want to give it a try? And so everything in life, you have to face it. You have to try it. There are so many people who are held back by fear and they don't want to even try a business idea that they have. And we're talking about thinking. Thoughts will flow in your head, but you're not going to even run with any because you're afraid of failure. There are lots of people who are afraid of failure. And in my training with my students, that's the one thing I try to pull out of them. Don't be afraid of trying out this style. Just try it. You can only learn from your failures. It's one of the greatest ways to learn. Fail. When you failed, then you learn from it. Then you know what you shouldn't be doing. And sometimes with my kids, when I've said something and they don't want to hear it, I just close my mouth and let them be. And once they've done it, they go, oh, now I know why you said that. Oh, really? Yeah, that's fine. So fear drives so many people to stop being there and doing their own thing. You shouldn't let fear hold you back. The other one is driven by materialism. Okay, so the desire to acquire is what drives lots of us as well. We just want to acquire everything that's out there. The drive to always get more. In this kind of person, all they're thinking is more will make me happy. Possessions only give you temporary happiness. That's what it is. Because the more you acquire, the more you want to acquire. You eventually become bored. Now you want the latest version of, I know young kids are like that. They get the iPhone 4 and they go, no, there's iPhone 5 now. Oh, no, there's iPhone 5C and iPhone 5 whatever. And then there's iPhone 6. And so we are now going to iPhone 7, iPhone 8. And it's like, when are you going to stop? And then, of course, when it comes to adults, it's like, you know, especially the ones with money. I've got Lamborghini and I want Jaguar and I want this and I want that. And then you get the ones like the politicians in Nigeria, they have houses all over UK. No, they want houses in the US. And then they want houses in Russia and the rest of Europe. And no one else counts because that's the only thing that drives them, materialism. But what you find is the more you get it, the more you want. The bigger, you might get one today and say, no, I want the bigger one. And I want the bigger one. Whatever these things are, they don't create you happiness. They might give you temporary happiness right now. You get the ones who want them Raymond Well or whatever these watches are. It's a myth. if I get more, I will be more important. That's what we say to ourselves. And it's even touching today, like the Instagram culture. Yes, I'm on Instagram showing you this, but you do it to a point. You get people who say, oh, I only got 10,000 likes on this picture. Let me do more. I actually saw a video once where this lady did, she did a bit of makeup. No, not makeup. She went for an operation to change her nose or something. And she's looking at other people's picture and then looking at herself. And she said, no, I want it to be like that. And she did the first one and she wasn't happy. And she went and did another one again. She looks at another picture, that still wasn't, and she went, we all saw what happened to Michael Jackson. I don't know his history, but we all saw how he changed slowly. So it's like, you don't want to get to the end of this road, because the more you get this one, no, that's not good enough, I want another one. And so you get 10,000 likes, you go, no, I want 50,000 likes, and what do I need to do to get that? And so, I heard people were beginning to take on debts just to hold maybe the latest this or the latest that, because that's the culture we've created in our young people, to think that it's all about materialism. And so we need to change that. God says the most valuable things in life are not things. The things God gives us for free are priceless. And so the air we breathe, how much did you pay for it? The person that you are, apart from when there are scenarios where mothers struggle and so they have to go and go through some processes to become pregnant, the child is priceless. Your nose, your eyes, your whatever it is that makes who you are, the cells in your body, you did not pay a penny for it. And so these are the things that matter in life. Is it me that having more money will make you secure? It won't, because there are very clear examples in life where people lose it all, completely lose it all. And then this is when it all goes wrong, because the minute you lose it all, you want to kill yourself, because all your life has been driven by owning that thing. And the next one is driven by approval. So we have people who think that the only way they can do something is to get other people to approve it. I've experienced this one a long time ago when I started this journey and I had people fighting me. Why are you going into hair? You're just a bit too much for hair. And I'm wondering, what do you know about me that you think I'm too much for hair? And who asked for your opinion about what I think? And there are people like that. Whatever they want to do, they want everybody else to approve it. I mean, I had a call the other day and someone was saying to me, oh, I was looking on the internet and I saw some reviews about your business, and this is a good review and that's a bad review. If I sit down here and keep watching what everybody says about me, I'm not going to move forward. Because then my life is held back. My energy is tied in waiting to hear what people are saying about me. There was a time I used to follow Kim Kardashian. I don't know if I still follow her, because sometimes my children just click on these people for me to follow. So when I'm going through, and then I see, and I'll see people, millions of people liking her, just liking, you know, that's on Instagram. They'll click. And then you read the comments, and these are the nastiest of comments ever. And I'm imagining if this young lady sits down to read these comments, she cannot wake up in the morning. But thank God sometimes they grow to that level where somebody else has to look at these things. But all these millions of people are put their eyeballs on this young lady, but still none of them are there with love. All they've come to do is just to hate. If we are driven by what people think, you're not going to get anywhere. Most of them are always worried about what others might think, do what other people want. Unfortunately, those who follow the crowd often get lost in it. Because you follow the crowd, you blend into the crowd. No one notices you because you blend in. You blend in so well, you don't stand out. And one key to failure is to please everyone. This is one key. He said he may not know the keys to success, but he sure knows the key to failure. Want to please everyone. Being controlled by the opinion of others guarantees you missing out on God's purpose. Because they didn't create you. Whoever's giving you these opinions did not create you. They don't know what you want. They don't know what your creator wanted out of you. I had a student once who was a nurse, and she decided she'd had enough of nursing and she wanted to learn how to work with hair. And her whole family abandoned her. She cried, "Coming, Joy, I don't know what to do. My sister thinks I'm wasting my time. Everyone around me thinks I'm wasting my time." And I said, do their opinions make a difference in your life? Because if it does, then you should buy it. But if you know your heart, then it's about what you think. And your heart is where God lies. So he says, Jesus reminds us that no one can serve two masters. So if you're busy following people who are giving you opinion, and then you're looking at yourself, you're going to lose. One person will lose. So it's up to you to start changing what you allow people to force on you. So benefits of purpose-driven living. So after he gave us all these options of what drives people, he's looking at now what should be the right way. And so this chapter 3 is one of those really, I don't know what the other chapters are like, but this one is really detailed. And so I'll quickly go through what he calls benefits of when you're driven by purpose. So 5 great benefits of life with purpose. Knowing your purpose gives you meaning, gives meaning to your life. And we are meant to have meaning. This is why some people try to know their future through psychic or through astrology or future tellers. Some of us go there and we say, could you tell me my future, please? Because you're lacking meaning. And so that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to find a purpose. Why are we here? And when life has meaning, you can bear it. Just like the young 20-year-old, the minute I know the meaning for my life, I can start living. So without God, life has no purpose. And without purpose, life has no meaning. I wrote that earlier in the little script. In the Bible, many people express this hopelessness. Isaiah, I have labored to no purpose. I have spent my strength in vain and for nothing. Life with purpose is knowing your purpose. We've talked about that one. And Isaiah was complaining that he has labored to no purpose. He has spent his strength in vain and for nothing. So most of us say that to ourselves because we don't know what we're doing. And that's why that's what we decided to do this, because I know I've been doing quite a lot. And then I just woke up one morning and I'm thinking, I still don't get it. Where am I going? Then I remember that I have to read this book. So Job, he said, my life drags by day after day, hopeless day, and I give up. I am tired of living. Leave me alone. My life makes no sense. Job said that. And the same thing Eckhart Tolle said, which was what attracted me to his book. He said, I am tired of living with myself. I'm going to end this life now. And that was when he realized that it wasn't just the one person in him. He realized that there must have been another person for him to say, I am tired of living with myself. So, you know, most of us with self-talk. No, most all of us we do. We have those many voices in our head, and this one saying that, and that one saying that, and that one saying that. So you don't know which one to listen to. And this is where we say we need to find out what the purpose is. So he says, hope is as essential to life as air and water. And this is one thing that most of us forget. Without hope, we lose it. If you don't have hope, you're wondering, oh, I'm so hopeless, I don't even know where there is hope right now. So we need to keep having that hope in focus. And that's where purpose comes in. He said, hope comes from having a purpose. He says, and for me personally, this was when it all came down to me. I was having these issues, marital issues, financial issues, emotional issues, and I was just having all types of things coming into my mind, and lost my business, and I'm wondering, am I making any more sense right now? And that's when I decided I should do this. If you feel hopeless, hold on to God. Changes are coming to your life as you begin to live on purpose. God said, I know what I am planning for you. Good plans, not to hurt you, to give you hope and to give you a good future. And we should also remember that we did not create ourselves. That's what I always try to remind all of us. The Creator, being God, knows why He created us. And that's why we have to hold on to Him. Because I've read somewhere too where, you know, when you buy any gadget, whatever gadget you buy a laptop, you buy a phone, everything comes with a manual. Ooh, this is how you open it, and this is how you put this here, and this is how you put that there, and this is what. But you just see yourself here, and there's no manual. You may just say, oh yeah, my mom is there, my dad is there, but do they really know what? So, knowing your purpose simplifies your life. So once you know what it is you're doing, your life is more simple. It defines what you do and not do. It becomes a standard you use to evaluate the activities that are essential. You ask, does this help me fulfill God's purpose for my life? Without purpose, you have no clear foundation to base your decisions or allocate your time or use your resources. You make choices based on circumstances. And these are people who have no purpose. You make choices based on pressures. You make choices based on your mood. Without purpose, you do too much. You get stressed, you get fatigued. You get conflict. And I was getting there. The Bible says a pretentious, showy life is an empty life. A plain and simple life is a full life, which also leads to peace of mind. So knowing your purpose, again, focuses your life. That's number three. So concentrate your effort and energy on what is important. So that's what happens when you know your purpose. You concentrate on what's important. You become effective by being selective. Humans get distracted by minor issues. So Henry David Thoreau observed, people live lives of quiet desperation. And he describes it as aimless distraction. So whenever you have no purpose, that's what happens. Aimless distraction. Everything that happens, you are part of it. I was getting there. I just wanted to do whatever I could see happening. It says once you have purpose, you will concentrate. All your energy will go in the right place. You know what's important. He said he described this aimless distraction like a gyroscope. It's a spinning around at a frantic pace, but never going anywhere. So without purpose, we keep changing directions. We keep changing relationships. We keep changing churches. We keep changing our friends. And that's because we don't even know what we're doing. And we're hoping that this will fill us up. It will fill that emptiness that we feel in our hearts. You need to think. The Bible says, don't live carelessly, unthinkingly. Make sure you understand what the Master wants. Master being your Creator. So power of focus can be seen in the light. So this is an example. When you have a light and it's dim, and you try to focus on something, it doesn't focus. It doesn't make any sense. But when light is focused, even as a laser beam, it can cut through steel. So what it's trying to tell us here is we should remain focused at all times. Once we stay focused, with this clear purpose, we will achieve it. The people who made the greatest differences in history were the most focused. So we'll look back a little bit into history and we'll see what happened to people. And Paul wrote in the Bible, I am focusing all my energies on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to the future. If you want your life to have an impact, focus it. That's what he's trying to tell us. He says we should do less. We should prune away every activity that doesn't make sense and focus on the ones that matter most. We should not confuse activity with productivity, because you can be busy without a purpose. And Paul said, let's keep focused on that goal. Those of us who want everything God has for us, we should stay focused on that goal. Number four, it says your purpose motivates your life. Once you know you have a purpose, you'll be motivated. And that's how I felt when I decided I'm going to be reading this book for 40 days. I felt so excited. The energy in me just came from nowhere. And so purpose produces passion. And nothing energizes like clear purpose. A clear purpose will just drive you on. A meaningless work wears you down and saps your strength and robs your joy. Number five, it says, knowing your purpose prepares you for eternity. So most people spend time trying to create a lasting legacy on earth, but what matters ultimately is not what others say about your life, but what God says. And one of the things God will ask you eventually is, what did you do with what I gave you? What did you do with your life on this earth? He gave you gifts, he gave you talents, he gave you opportunities, he gave you energy, he gave you relationships, he gave you resources. He's going to ask, did you spend them on yourself? Did you use it wisely? Did you use it for God's purpose? And of course, the other one about eternity is, did you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior? But of course, when it comes to that, Christians, which I am on, we know that Jesus is our Savior. But you know what your Savior is if you're not a Christian. But these are the things that really drives us. These are the things we should be aiming for. These are what creates our purpose in life. So I hope I made a bit of sense today to chat with you about my journey going on this purpose-driven life. We didn't really get any questions today, so I'm hoping it made sense. That's why nobody thought I needed to be asked any question. So we'll see you tomorrow when we delve into chapter 4. I look forward to seeing you then. And stay focused and stay on purpose, and God bless you.